Sorry about that. Hi, everyone, and welcome to our weekly language clinic. My name is Neil, and I'll be here for the next 30 or 40 minutes to answer all of your questions about learning English. So all you have to do is say hello, say where you're watching from in the comments, and ask any questions that you have about anything, about grammar, vocabulary, skills, writing, speaking, reading, listening, exams, pronunciation, anything that you like, anything that pops into your head, you can put into the comments and I will try to answer. I'm just seeing we've got people joining us now. Okay, I see from Cyprus, from the Philippines, from Hong Kong, lots of people. I don't know where you're from because you haven't said, but lots of other people. Pakistan, Madagascar, Brazil. What other countries have we got coming up here? Okay, lots of different ones there. Egypt, of course. Myanmar. And others. Okay, well, hello everyone. So as I say, I'm here for 30 or 40 minutes. I'll try to answer as many questions as I can in that time. Please try to make your question as specific as possible. You know, it's not, I can't, if you ask me, how can I improve my English? We would be here all day because there are a million ways. But if you ask me something about one particular piece of grammar or vocabulary or pronunciation, then I can give you a quick answer. And you can go away happy, I hope. Okay, I'm going to start just by looking at some questions that came in last week that we didn't manage to get to, either because they were a bit late or after we finished, or we just didn't have time. But I'm going to do a few of these first. That will give you all time to think about your question and post it in the comments, and then I'll answer all of those as well. Okay, so the first question from last week is from Hack Etashamul Jr., who's saying, how are you keeping? Is this saying formal and can we use it in our everyday conversation? Two different questions there. How are you keeping? No, it's not formal. It's quite informal. It's friendly. It's something that's absolutely fine to use in conversation, though, with, you know, a friend, an acquaintance, a colleague at work, anything like that. Absolutely no problem to say, how are you keeping, instead of how are you doing, or how are you, or whatever that you use instead. How are you keeping? Basically just means, how are you doing? How are things going? So there's lots of ways. How are you? How are you doing? How are you keeping? How are things going? How are things? All of these are relatively informal and, you know, conversational. So you can use them in everyday conversation. Yes. Damaris Ubise Betancourt says, please, could you pronounce this word? No problem. This is a quick one and easy. This word is shareholder. Shareholder. And a shareholder is a person who owns shares in a company. Anyone who owns shares, whether it's one share or a million shares, they are a shareholder. Okay. Just a couple more from last week, and then we can have a look at your new questions. Takiti Falana, what's the difference between throw up, throw down, throw out, and throw away? It's a good question, and this is a good way to learn your phrasal verbs, to learn them in groups like that. You know, choose a root verb like throw or look or, you know, anything that goes with that, and then learn the different phrasal verbs, a cough to begin and now a sneeze. Sorry, I hope I'm not getting sick. It is winter. Anyway, you know, to choose the verb like throw and then look at all the possible phrasal verbs that come from that and then learn them. That's a good way to remember. So let's talk about these ones. Throw up. Okay, throw up could have two meanings. One could be literal, to throw up in the air. He threw the ball up in the air. That's one possibility. But the phrasal verb for this is to throw up. It means to be sick, to vomit for, you know, for your food to come back up like that. So he got food poisoning and he threw up all night. Okay, so that's to throw up, meaning to be sick. Throw down is an unusual one. It's not really very common as a phrasal verb. Again, you can have it as a literal sense. You know, I could look up at you in the balcony and I could say, throw down the key, meaning to throw the key in a downward direction to me. I'm on the ground, you're on the first floor, I say, throw down the key. That's possible. As a phrasal verb with a different meaning, there's a very uncommon use, not very common one, related to music. Sometimes, you know, you'll hear people say, they were throwing down some great tunes last night at the concert, meaning playing music in that way. So it can mean that, but it's not very common for that. Throw out and throw away basically mean the same thing. You know, I threw out all my old clothes. I threw away all my old clothes. It means that I got rid of them. I disposed of them. I put them in the bin, put them out, you know, like that. So throw out and throw away. There's not really much difference there. I guess the difference is if you throw something out, then it means it was in. So it was in your house. So, for example, like I said, I threw out all my old clothes. Both are correct, but I threw out all my old clothes means they were in my house and I threw them out. I put them in the bin outside. Throw away could also be the same. I threw away all my old clothes. Absolutely possible. But the difference is you could also use it for just when you're outside. You know, he threw away the empty can, or he threw away the litter. You know, so it just means to get rid of, the same thing, to dispose of, to put in the bin or something. But it doesn't have to be, you know, something that is in your house that belongs to you or something in that way. So that's the difference, I guess, but it's not a big difference. And very often they're interchangeable. I have one more question from last week, but we've got so many new questions coming in. I'm going to start looking at them instead for the moment. Oh, goodness. When I said so many, I wasn't joking. There's a lot. Okay. Okay. From Claudia P. Ortiz, can you explain when I can use superlatives? Yep, absolutely. No problem at all. Basically, if we talk about an adjective, okay, something like big, okay, simple adjective. So you have two forms of that adjective. You have three forms, rather. You've got the base adjective, then you've got the comparative, so bigger than. So, for example, London is bigger than Glasgow, okay, comparison. We use the superlative to mean the thing that is the most of whatever adjective you're talking about, the biggest, the most quality. So if we're talking about big, London is a big city. London is bigger than Glasgow. London is the biggest city in the UK. Only one, the biggest. Okay, the very top, the highest level of whatever adjective you're talking about. Tall, taller, tallest. He's the tallest person in class. He's the one person who is taller than all the other students, so he's the tallest. And that's what the superlative means. It means the one which is bigger, better, faster, stronger, whatever, than all the others. Okay. Let's move on. Oh, so many countries. Sudan and Georgia, Egypt, Senegal, Russia, Colombia, Angola. Great. It's lovely to see so many countries here. It's always really nice. Right. Du Ming Hong saying, can we tell you a few popular idioms or slangs that are used in your place? I could probably tell you hundreds, but I'm not going to do it just now. If you check our, you're watching us on Facebook, so if you check our Facebook page, Learn English British Council, you'll find that we share lots of posts. If you look at the photos, you'll see lots of posts with vocabulary for things like slang phrases and popular phrases. And, you know, just read through, take a look at them, find the ones that you like, and then practice using them yourself. Manuel is saying, give us several clues, hints how we can get a crash course in the UK, for example, a 2-week crash course. I'm not sure I can really give you much information on that. I mean, there are a lot of summer courses, you know, intensive summer courses for adults in the UK. But we, the British Council, don't actually run those ourselves in the UK. But you can go to the British Council website, britishcouncil.org, and you can find a list of accredited schools. So schools that have been inspected and examined and found to be of good quality for this. And you could do that, and then you can just basically, you know, email them, inquire, find out about that. This is a statement from Mr. Bashar Bashir, which is, there's a big problem in vocabulary between slang and formal English. You'd have to tell me more. Is it a problem that you have? Is it something that you want to ask about? Is there some specific example that you're not sure about or something? You know, I don't know if there's a problem. There's a difference, certainly. You know, there's slang at one end of the spectrum. There's informal English, which is not necessarily slang, but is just less formal English. There's semi-formal English, then there's formal English and very formal English. And yes, they're all different, and it's important to learn the differences. But I don't know what you mean by there's a big problem with it. So you'd have to tell me a little bit more about that in your question. Okay. Moving on very quickly. Lots. Manuel, I wish I could be a shareholder. Me too, Manuel. Me too. Côte d'Ivoire, Ethiopia, lots more countries there. Okay. How to practice stress timing and connected speech? Are there approaches or websites from Yuli you recommend to use for this purpose? It's a good question. It's not an easy one. Websites for pronunciation and things like that are there's not so many of them as you would think. It's not quite so common. You know, BBC Learning English certainly has some excellent pronunciation resources, and it's worth looking at them for that. There are some tools that maybe I'll share in the comments later where you can look for and search for examples of phrases and sentences from YouTube spoken by people, so you can hear how they sound in a sentence. So you're not just learning individual words, you're looking at whole sentences and phrases and seeing how they work, and that can help. But really, the best way, you know, is focusing on your listening practice. Listen for examples, you know, listen for how sentences are structured and how the connected speech works, and you know, the stress timing and so on within that. And then just try to practice, try to copy it, try to make your, you know, when you're speaking. So, for example, you could go to our website, get a transcript of one of our videos, which is on the website, listen to the video, then practice reading the transcript and saying it yourself. Record yourself and then compare the stress and the connected speech within that to see if it's the same, if it's similar, or if yours is more choppy or broken up, or if the stress is not quite right within this. Just, you know, by practicing listening and comparing, that can really help. There are some websites that explain connected speech and so on within that, and will explain some of the ways that it works, some of the mechanics of it. But I'm not sure about a website that actually, you know, helps you to practice it as such. Maybe I'll have a look and see what I can find. Okay, Sandra Swadikani, I'm not sure about the pronunciation, sorry if I got it wrong, is asking, phrasal verbs, are they used more in American or British English? No. They're used widely in all English. You know, it's very common. Phrasal verbs are very, very, very common in everyday speech, whether it's American English or British English, Canadian English, Irish English, Australian English, whatever. That's why it's important to learn them. They're very, very common. We use them in everyday speaking all the time. You know, but they're not more common in one language than another. They're more common in informal, friendly, everyday conversation than formal conversation. But in terms of countries, no difference at all. This is from Sarah Streeter. I'm hoping that this is a reply to the earlier question about throw up and not a comment on today's language clinic. That would upset me. Let's move on. Okay. Question from Susan. Hi, Susan. Haven't spoken to you for a long time because I haven't been in some of our meetings, but let's see. Could you please talk about passive, when we use it, or if I can't understand it, can I just avoid using it? That's an excellent question. You can avoid using it. Yeah, absolutely. You know, any sentence which exists in passive form can be said in the active voice. Absolutely. But I wouldn't recommend it. I wouldn't recommend avoiding it because it is very useful at times. The thing about passive is that the focus, you know, what you're interested in is the object of the verb, not the subject. So, a classic example would be paper was invented by the Chinese. Okay. Typical example you'll find in textbooks or dictionaries and things like that. Now, I could say the Chinese invented paper, absolutely, and it's grammatically correct and it's fine and there's nothing wrong with it. But if I'm talking about paper, if my article is about paper or my presentation or my conversation and paper is what I'm interested in, then that is the most important thing in that sentence. And in English, what happens, some languages, you know, you have a lot of flexibility in how you can move words around in a sentence. But in English, what we tend to do is we put the most important information, the focus, at the beginning of the sentence, you know. So if I'm talking about paper, I'm saying, you know, paper is incredibly useful. Paper changed the world. Paper made the transmission of knowledge possible and, you know, helped the development of society dramatically. Paper was invented by the Chinese. It wouldn't be wrong if I said the Chinese invented paper, but it wouldn't be logical because everything I'm talking about is paper, paper, paper. I'm focused on paper. Paper is what I want to, you know, give you the information about, not people, but paper. So your question is when can we use it? It's as simple as that. That's you know, you can read our website, our grammar section about passives, and read the rules and how it's constructed. You know, the passive is basically the verb to be in whatever tense you're using plus the past participle. So be would be, you know, is for the present tense, was, were for the past tense, have, has, been for present perfect tense, will be, etc. It's the verb be and then the past participle. So will be made, has been made, is made, etc. But, you know, the question of when you use it, really, the key point is just the one I said there. The key point is that you use it when you're more interested in the object of a verb, or the object of the verb is more important, or sometimes because you don't know the subject. You know, my car was stolen, for example. Okay, I could say someone stole my car. Absolutely fine. And, you know, maybe I would, if it just happened, I might come in and say, someone stole my car. It's terrible. I don't have a car, so, you know, it was stolen. No. You might say that. But if you're making a report to the police, the important part is you don't know who stole the car. The important part is the car is gone. So, again, you'd say probably my car was stolen at 9 p.m. yesterday. Okay. It's, you don't know who did it, so you can't say it would. You could say it was stolen by someone, but what does that tell you? Who? I don't know. So it's not important. But the car is what you're focused on. My car was stolen. Okay. So yes, it's important. Yes, it's useful. Yes, you can avoid it. But I recommend that you don't avoid it and that you practice with it. It's honestly not that difficult. Go to our website, check the grammar section. It maybe looks difficult, you know, if it's not used or common in your language, perhaps it might be seem difficult. But honestly, it's not difficult. Once you've got the structure, it's very straightforward. And once you understand the use, what I was just talking about, why you would use it, when you would use it, I think you'll find it's not as bad as you think. Okay. Okay, Teresita Tejeran, is it ideal to use the word effects in writing an academic research title? It's a difficult question for me to answer because I don't know the topic of your research, but the word effects is absolutely fine for you know, so it could be something like, for example, the effects of sleep loss on something, you know, absolutely, you know, the effects to talk about the results, to talk about the things that happened because of something, absolutely, it's a perfectly good word for academic formal writing, for anything else, no problem there. Okay. This is not a language question, but I'll answer because it's, you know, you asked, so why not? Where are you from? I'm from Scotland. I don't live in Scotland. I live in Slovakia, but I'm from Scotland in the United Kingdom. Okay. Tajikistan, another country there. That's India, Kenya, lots more. Okay. Just scrolling through Syria, Italy, Romania. Okay, lots and lots there. Uzbekistan, Tunisia. Okay. Okay, I think I might have got a cold. This is not good. I don't want to be sneezing for 30 minutes here, but I can feel another one coming on, so get ready. Okay. Fiorella Toma, could you explain the use of by far? Good question. Okay. Earlier, we had a question about superlatives, and, you know, I talked about London is the biggest city in the UK, for example. Now, by far is an intensifier. It modifies, it gives you more information about a superlative like that. Okay, so for example, I could say London is the biggest city in the UK. Perfect sentence, grammatically correct, accurate information, tells you everything you need to know. But if I wanted to emphasize that, if I wanted to say that it's much, much, much bigger than all the other cities, then I could use by far. I could say London is by far the biggest city in the UK. And what by far tells you is that the difference, you know, remember the superlative is the top one of whatever we're talking about. It tells you that the difference between that and the others is very big. That's what it's saying. So, you know, by far the biggest city means it's much, much bigger than any other. That was by far the best meal I've ever had. It was much, much better than any other meal. Okay. So that's basically what you use it with. You use it with a superlative to make that stronger, to emphasize that the difference between that superlative and all the other things you're talking about is very big. Okay. I'm going to ask you to ask Ala Eldin Hassan. I'm going to ask you to ask this question again because I'm not 100% clear what you're asking. You say I'm about to subscribe in an English language app that's concentrated on the speaking section. Do you think the speaking section will make a difference? If you mean, do I think that practicing with whatever this app is and that's focused on practicing speaking, can it help you? I don't know the app, so I don't know if it's a good app, an okay app, or not so good app. But in theory, absolutely. You know, any speaking practice is going to help you. And if it is a good app with lots of practice and lots of guidance and information on how to prepare for speaking and how to practice speaking, and then, you know, to give you a chance to actually do it and perhaps record yourself and so on, absolutely, it will help you. You know, I would recommend using any tool that you can and, you know, try it and see. You might find it helps you, you might not, but I mean, it's certainly worth trying. And if the question is, can it help you? Then if it's a good app, then yes, it can and probably will. Okay. Okay, bear with me for just one second while I open a page. Where are we? Okay. Okay, here's one from Yumna Ayub. Please, I need a simple definition of a gerund. In other meaning, a simple way to explain it for my students. Okay, I mean, gerund, it's not that complicated. So I think you should be able to explain it to your students. I think your students should be able to get this when they're working with it. A gerund is basically, it's a verb that acts as a noun. Okay, so it comes from a verb and you add ing at the end. And then it's not talking about the action. So, for example, I was swimming yesterday. That's a verb. That's, you know, that's me saying the past continuous. I was swimming. Okay, I'm talking now. That's a verb, not a gerund. Okay, that's a present participle. But the gerund is when you take that ing form and you use it like a noun. So, for example, swimming is good for your health. Okay, it's the same word that I just used as a noun, but now I'm using it. It's because of my cold. It's the same word I just used as a verb, but now I'm using it as a noun. It's the subject of that sentence. So swimming is good for your health. No difference in form, same spelling, same word, but it's now acting as a noun. Talking is difficult talking is difficult when you have a sore throat, for example. There, I'm using talking as a gerund again. Another example, he's very good at swimming, okay? He's very good at swimming, the noun, the action, the activity. It's not a verb there, it's a gerund within that, okay? And the way to test, perhaps the best way to explain this or to your students or to show it to your students is to replace the gerund with a noun in the sentence. So for example, let me think of a good example. I like eating, as you can tell. I mean, I'm not the thinnest person on the internet. I like eating, okay? Now, if you look at that sentence, it's eating. I am eating would be a verb. I like eating is a gerund. You can replace that. Take eating out and you can say, I like football. I like music. I like eating. Okay? I like travel, whatever. Okay? So that shows you that it's a gerund. That's the way to kind of do it. Make it a noun. Same at the beginning of a sentence. You know, swimming is good for your health. That's a gerund. You could replace it with, exercise. Exercise is good for your health. Okay? It's a noun. So basically, that's how to think about it and how to explain it to your students. It comes from the verb. It has the same form as the ing form of the verb, but it's used as a noun. And I think your students should be okay with that if you explain it in that way. Okay, talking about present, continuous, and so on, and ing forms, Farah's saying, what's the difference between I eat Let's say instead of meal, because that doesn't really work in I eat meal, let's say I eat food. Okay, fine. I eat food and I'm eating food. The difference is that the present simple, I eat food, is a fact, something that is always true about you. You know, you eat food. You eat food now, you eat food every day, you eat food to live. It's a fact, it's a general fact, it's always true, you eat food. It's not talking about the action that of doing it, it's just talking about the fact that you eat food. I'm eating food is talking about the action. It means that right now, at this moment, I'm eating food. It's an activity, it's something I'm doing. I'm taking food and I'm putting it in my mouth. Okay, it's different. I eat food is just a general fact. I'm eating food is an action that's happening right now. And that's true for every verb that you're using in that. Okay. Okay. Griezmann dos Santos, is it right mixing British and American English when we're talking? Well, here's the thing. I'm not here to judge, and I don't think anyone should judge. So right is not the question here. It's not a right or wrong. I would never say it's wrong. It's absolutely fine. People do it all the time, you know, for various reasons. I mean, you know, when people travel, they pick up different words, different expressions, and they use them. Watching TV, movies, you know, Netflix, whatever, Disney, whatever, you're listening to British English, Australian English, American English, and you're going to pick up phrases, vocabulary, expressions from all of them. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with mixing them. You know, is it right? I mean, should you do it? It's up to you. I mean, it's, you know, the main thing, the reason you're learning English, the reason you're using English is to communicate and to communicate your ideas and your thoughts and to help other people to understand them. How you do that is up to you. It's, you know, if it's successful, if you're able to communicate clearly, then it's right. It's good. That's all there is to it. And, you know, if you want to use American English and British English, no problem. If you want to throw in some Irish English, some Indian English, you know, some Nigerian English, whatever you want in there, also fine. Okay? So don't worry about it. Focus on the communication and getting your ideas across. Don't worry about whether you're using American or British within that. When it comes to writing, the only thing I would say is spelling. Choose one spelling form, either British or American English, so that it's always the same, because it looks better. You know, people might think it's a mistake if you do it differently. Even from the point of view of your computer, if you're using Word or something, the spell check has to be set in one English or the other. And if you set it in one and then mix it, it will tell you all these things that are wrong. And, you know, you don't want that. So basically for writing, choose one or the other. But for speaking, you know, do what you like. Okay. These are good questions from Du Meng Hong. They're just very difficult ones to answer very quickly or short. What is considered to be rude in your country? Many things, like in your country too, I'm sure. Let me think about that. And I remember, I think I know a good video that actually talks about things that really annoy people in the UK. And you know, there are things like that. People, you know, people not saying thank you when you hold a door open for them. People jumping ahead of you in a queue, things like that are very unpopular. But there are so many ways to be rude. It's difficult for me to give you a list there. Ahmed Zakwan, how could I increase my vocabulary? The single best way to increase your vocabulary is to read in English. It doesn't matter what you read. Okay, whatever you're interested in, it can be newspapers, it can be magazines, it can be blogs, it can be websites about cars or football or science, doesn't matter. But reading will help you improve your vocabulary, because every time you read something in English, every time, you will find something that you don't quite understand, or something that is new for you. Or you'll see words that you already know, but used in a different way that will teach you expressions or phrases that you can use. So really, reading is my number one recommendation for that. And, you know, some people like reading, some people don't like reading. So what I'm saying is, don't feel you have to read something you don't like. Just follow your heart. Whatever you're interested in, whatever you read in your own language, try reading in English. And if you just do a little bit of that every day, 15 minutes a day, you'll find that it helps you tremendously. That at the end of 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, you'll have learned so much new vocabulary, okay? Of course, you have to write it down and practice and use it and remember it. But really, if you just do that, that's the number one thing. Listening is good too, but reading is number one. Reading is absolutely the best way to learn new vocabulary. Okay, I'm just thinking about a question there. I'll come back to you in a moment for that. Okay, from Mongolia. That's nice. We don't get so many people from Mongolia, so it's always nice when it comes to that. It's great. Where to begin to understand a movie? Could you tell me some good example? Okay, my advice here would be, don't start with a movie. Movies are long, noisy, fast, and difficult. I would recommend starting with shorter things. Start with some YouTube videos, some short videos, and then maybe try things like comedy shows from TV, you know, whether it's like old ones like Friends or it's new ones, you know, anything like that. Just comedy, short comedy programs, because they're usually only... American comedy shows are usually only 22 minutes long because of the advertisements and so on. So 22 minutes is much easier to concentrate for and to work with than 3.5 hours or 2.5 hours for a movie. So I would start there. Start with TV shows rather than movies. Watch them with subtitles. Then try watching them without the subtitles. See how much you understand. You know, work with that. Look for, watch it without subtitles. See how much you understand. See what you think about it. Then put the subtitles on when you don't understand something. Learn the vocabulary. Learn what they're saying. But start that way. Start with short videos, maybe 5 minute, 10 minute videos from YouTube or TED Ed or something like that. Then try comedy series from TV. Wherever, Netflix or, you know, download it, whatever you watch them, to do with that, British, American, it doesn't matter for that. And, you know, once you've done that for a while, once you've got into the habit of watching your favorite TV shows again and again every week for whatever like that, then you'll gradually begin to notice that it's becoming much easier for you and you're understanding more. And then you can maybe try a movie. But try a movie, you know, aim for a movie that's something like a drama or comedy about everyday life, not something that is, you know, going to be full of difficult language, like some science fiction film or something like that, and not something like Shakespeare or something like that, but just some nice, simple movie about, you know, romance or everyday life. You know, a rom-com, a comedy, something like that. And you know, just that way, work up to it. Start with short videos, longer TV shows, maybe a longer TV show after that, something that's not a comedy, maybe, you know, a documentary or something. And then after that, maybe try a movie. But step by step is the way, really, for this. Okay. Sandra, why is it so easy to understand when I watch an explanation like yours and so hard when I see a movie? Because I speak beautiful English, Sandra. That's why, honestly. No, it's for the reasons I just talked about. Movies, lots of different accents, people talking at the same time, often talking very, very fast. You know, sometimes even I as a native speaker of English, have to put on subtitles when I'm watching something, because the combination of the noise, the accents, the people talking at once, it makes it hard for me to sometimes focus as well. So it's normal. But, you know, one person speaking like this clearly is obviously is going to be easier and better. But like I said, the more you practice with everything, the easier it will get, even with things like movies. But it just takes time. Okay, almost running out of time. Yeah. This is really just kind of summarizing the same things I was saying earlier about the passive there. You know, exactly. It's about where the object is what's important, where maybe the subject is unknown. I said my car was stolen, and the subject is well known by everyone. That's another one that I didn't really touch on, but you'll find that in our website. Okay. Ulmana Joseph, what would you advise someone who doesn't know their level of English? Very good question. Getting an accurate, a really, you know, 100% accurate picture of your level of English is not easy. That's why we have tests like IELTS, you know, where you go through a long test of reading, speaking, writing, and listening, and then all of your English is evaluated, is assessed for your level. But you get shorter tests. If you go to a British Council teaching centre, for example, they'll give you what they call a placement test, and that will involve answering some questions and then a short interview, and you know they'll tell you your level. Online, we have a level test, a free level test on our Learn English website. Tina's answering comments in the chat, but let me just see if I can. I'm not sure if she'll have seen this one. So yeah, so let me just find this. I'll pop it into the comments myself in a moment. Okay. Okay, in the comments, if you check in the comments, you'll see a link that says "Test Your Level," and that's to our Learn English website. And you'll find a test there that you have to answer different questions, and then comment on those questions, and then it will give you an approximate level. I can't say that it will be 100% accurate, because to be 100% accurate, like I say, you would need to do some writing and listening and perhaps an interview. But it will give you a pretty good idea of where you are. You know, it will test your reading, your vocabulary, your understanding of grammar, and so on. And it will give you an idea of where you are. And then once you've done that test and it tells you what level you are, then you can look at the activities on our website and try them. And if you find them, so let's say it says you're B2, and you go and do B2 activities on our website. If you find that they're quite easy and that you're always getting 100% correct and every answer is good, then you can try the C1 activities. And if you find that you're getting some right and some wrong, then that means that your level is somewhere between B2 and C1. You know, so you know that's kind of the way to do it. The test will give you a basic guide. It will say, right now, you know, we think you are here, but you can practice more and find out, you know, perhaps you're a little bit higher than that, perhaps you're a little bit lower than that. You might find that in the B2 activities, you're finding them difficult, or you're getting a lot of questions wrong, and so on. So, you know, that will tell you you're in the right place, but you still have some work to do. Okay. I really like this question, but I can't answer it just now because it's a very big question. But Manaz is saying, how can we teach English to students on social media platforms such as WhatsApp? Any tips would be great. WhatsApp is actually excellent for that. You're right, and so are other social media platforms. I mean, there are different ways to do it. You know, you can share resources with them. You can share activities and things for them to read or listen to, even on WhatsApp, and then ask questions. You can have voice conversations as a group. You can have chat conversations. All of that would be helping them. But it's a big question as to what type of activity and how to make it work best. I'll look for an article for you that might help you with that, because it's not an easy question. You know, using WhatsApp is a good idea, and it can really help, and you can use it for teaching and learning, absolutely. But to go beyond just, you know, using it for chat or something, then yeah, you do need to think carefully about what can you do, what type of content could you use on it, and what type of activity could you ask people for. Okay. Okay, a bit of a long text here, but I'm going to just quickly say it. It's from Najam saying, my question is, what's the easy way to understand the proper and correct use of prepositions? There isn't one. Sorry, no, prepositions are quite difficult because they're very often not the same as in your language. If you have prepositions in your language, they don't always seem logical. You know, you might find that you have to use one preposition with an adjective, for example, and not another one, even though it seems logical to use the other one. Sometimes you might find that things, you know, so basically there isn't an easy way. The only way to really learn prepositions is to pay attention to them and to make a good vocabulary record of them. You know, look for patterns, look for words that go together with the same preposition, look for phrases that use prepositions within that, and just, you know, keep practicing and keep writing them down and keep recording them. And when you're reading, pay attention to how they work. When you're writing vocabulary down, for example, I don't know, simple example, good, for example. Okay, good is an adjective. Good is an adjective there for that. A simple example would be, don't just write good, but write prepositions that go with it and phrases. So he's good at English. My holiday was good for me. My parents were very good to me. I'm trying to think if there are any more. You know, but that's an example. So that adjective can go together with three or more different prepositions. And, you know, just learn like that and put them together and keep practicing. But you really do have to learn them as you discover them, as you meet them, and, you know, as you come across them in English and practice using them. I'm going to put one more link into the chat here that will help you. I just put in a link in the comments to a tool called OSDIC, and this is a collocations dictionary, and it has, among other things, it tells you how words go together and what words go together. But one thing it's very good at is it tells you all the prepositions that go together with whatever words you're looking up in that. And you can look at that, and that will help you to explore and to practice and to learn within that. Okay. Nice question from Javier here. What's the correct use of clothes? Clothes is red or clothes are red? Good question. Clothes is plural, so it's are. Okay, clothes are red. I don't know if it's different in other languages, you know, perhaps where that would not be the case, but it's plural. Okay, clothes. So always, his clothes are dirty, his clothes are red, these clothes are very nice, etc. Clothes are. Never clothes is, unless you say clothes is an English word, for example. That would be possible. Okay. Rabello's saying, I often use Quizlet. That's another excellent tool. We're talking about vocabulary. A lot of people have been asking, how can you learn vocabulary? People were asking about how to learn prepositions, phrasal verbs, all these things. Quizlet is a very good tool that you can find online. Just Google it, Quizlet, and it's really useful. It has a lot of things that can really help you to learn vocabulary and to learn collocations and to learn things like prepositions that go together with words. Okay. Okay, I'll go back to that. Okay. Right, I've only got a few more minutes left. I'm going to go to the most recent questions and see what I've got. Okay, question from Yuli. Any tips for the case of unknown words in the topics or graphs of the IELTS writing task? It's an interesting question. I'm trying to think how it could come up in the IELTS graphs question. Generally, I mean, it can happen. I can think, you know, for example, I could think that it could happen. I can imagine it in a process diagram in IELTS, for example, that it might be describing some machinery in some process and you don't know, you know, it talks about something like photovoltaic cells or something, and you don't know what photovoltaic cells are. You've never heard the word before. But that's not going to be an issue because, you know, with nouns, with things like that, you just use the word that's in the task, you know. So if you were talking about that, so let's say I'm talking about a process, you know, that's photovoltaic cells are what are used to convert sunlight to electricity in solar panels. Okay, so if you were describing that, if that was what you had to describe in your IELTS test, then you would still just say, photovoltaic cells convert sunlight to electricity. It doesn't matter if you're not sure what a photovoltaic cell is or about the science or anything to do with it. You just use the word as it is, use the expression as it is. And the important part is describing the process, which is your own words. That's what you're using for that. So I wouldn't worry about that. In graphs, it would be similar. You know, if there is some element in the graph that is a word you don't know, that's not the important part. The important part is the relationship, is, you know, what that thing, whatever it is, that thing you don't know, how it relates to the other things in the graph, or what change there has been, or what progress there's been, or, you know, anything like that. So it could be a made-up word. It could be, I don't know, frumble or something. You don't know what it means, but that's not what you're being asked about. You know, you're going to use that word, but you're going to talk about it to say there's twice as much frumble as there is mumble or whatever. Frumble increased rapidly over the six-month period. So the word... you just use the word. That's it. You use the word that's there, whether you understand it or not. What's important is to describe the situation, the change, the comparison, whatever you're dealing with that. So don't panic. Don't worry if you find a word in task one that you don't know. Forget about it. Focus on the task. And the task is to describe the data that is in front of you and to make comparisons where it's necessary. Okay, you can do that even if you don't know any of the words that are the items that you're describing. Okay, because you can read the graph, you understand the graph, you can see the relationship, you can see the comparisons. You know, it doesn't matter if you know what the words are or not, you can still do the task, and that's what to focus on. Okay, very last question. This is not a question, but it's a comment from Lily Lopez. Prepositions are my problem. Prepositions are everyone's problem. Okay, prepositions and articles are often the two things that cause the most problems for people, even after their English is excellent in every other way. So, you know, you're not alone. Don't, but just again, like I said, practice, practice, practice. Trainer teacher Ben, hello from Morocco. Can you recommend applications or websites that can help in preparing for the IELTS exam? Yes, our own British Council website, Take IELTS, it's called. If you just Google that, or maybe I can find it and pop it into the chat again. Sorry. Just give me one second. Okay. I've added this to the chat, and you can see the link there. The prepare section of the website there is full of advice and resources, practice tests, guides to the questions, webinars that you can sign up for, lots of stuff to help you. Okay. Right. I think that's going to have to be my last question. I left trainer teaching. Okay. But let me just, I'm just having a quick look to see if there's anything. Quick one from Sega Gide here. Thanks for your time. My question is, I listen very well, but I can't speak very well. What's your advice for me? Just do it. That's my advice. Okay. I know it feels that you can't do it, and you're shy and nervous and you know, worried about your English and speaking. But if you're listening well, if you're learning vocabulary, if you have the words that you need to say what you want to say, don't worry about anything else. Just try. It's 100% about practice. You can visit our website and you can take a look at our speaking section. That might help you with I'm just gonna another link. Hold on, what have I done? I think I've lost it. Hold on. I'll pop this into the chat as well. Just give me one moment. Right. I've put a link in the chat to our skills section on our website, and there you can find listening, speaking, reading, and writing. And if you go to the speaking section, you'll find videos that can help you practice, that will give you a chance to join in conversations and practice with that. But really, it's just, you know, if you feel your listening is good, if you feel your vocabulary is quite good, it's really just about having the confidence to practice. So speak to yourself if you don't have somebody to speak to. If you have a friend or colleague to speak to, practice speaking with them. Practice, you know, recording yourself on video if you want, whatever. But just do it. Just, you know, practice speaking about something. Our website's full of activities that can help you with that. You can practice dialogues, but you can also just practice talking. Let's say you've just watched a movie. You can just practice talking about the movie and say why you enjoyed it, what you know, everything, anything is good practice, but it's all about doing. So don't worry about it. Don't put it off. Don't think I can't do it. Just try. And the more you try and the more often you try, the easier it will become. And, you know, you'll get there. Everyone can learn to speak English well. You know, everyone, without exception. So it's just about practice. Okay, time is up. I'm going to have to stop now. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for all your great questions. Again, I answered as many as I could, but there's still a lot that I didn't have time to answer, but I'll try and answer these a bit later on. And if I don't get to them this week, today, then I'll answer them at the beginning of next week as well. So you can come back next week and watch again, and we'll see you there. Okay, but I'm going to have to say goodbye for now. So thank you a lot for coming, and bye for now.